Hello, welcome to the encouraging word of today. Today is Monday, August the 2nd. Can you believe it? We are already in the month of August. Time is flying by. But as we have been through the journey of the book of Joel, as we have seen where God says, can you not look around and see that things are being stripped away right before your very eyes? All the goodness is being stripped away, and there's only one way for that to be restored. There's only one way for you to have a right relationship with the God who's given you all the things, and that is to repent and truly repent. Not just say you need it or say the nation needs it, but truly repent with sackcloth and ashes and weeping and fasting and mourning and rending your hearts and not your garments. He says, man, I'm tired of the outward expressions that you want repentance. You it's got to be real and genuine. And if that happens, then I'll restore. And that's the whole message of the gospel in its entirety. That when we are found by the God of heaven and earth, most of the time our lives has found itself in misery and destruction and pain. We recognize that the goodness has been stripped away because of sin. And regardless of how deep the sin is, that's the reality of it, that sin separates us from God. It strips away the goodness in our lives. And until we repent of our sin and put our faith in Jesus Christ, we cannot be restored because that's God's heart and desire, is that we would recognize the severity of our sin, that we would see how it destroys everything around us, but how God desires for us to have the forgiveness of our sin and to have eternal life, to be able to be restored and God give all the good things that he loves to give his children. And so this is the gospel, really. The book of Joel is the gospel, how God longs to restore those who have lost their way. And so when we pick up now today, we're going to pick up in the short book of Philemon. Now the short book of Philemon is the shortest letter of the Apostle Paul. It's only one chapter long, and even though it's the shortest chapter, the shortest book that Paul wrote in the New Testament, he wrote 14 books, and this book is the shortest of all of those books, but it has a powerful message of reconciliation with inside of it, how God expects us to accept those who come to Christ, and the kind of love and fellowship and restoration that they deserve because they are in the Lord Jesus Christ. And so, as we pick up today, we're going to look at verse 1. Really just verse 1 today, because verse 1 is packed full of these marvelous truths that we can have to hold in our hearts. So first of all, it says the word Paul. Now, of course, we know Paul was Saul of Tarsus. And Saul of Tarsus was a man in the Roman world, a man of great affluence, a man of power and authority. And as a matter of fact, his salvation experience occurred as he was on his way to Damascus to find any of those that were in the way. That would be those who had began to follow the message and the Savior of Jesus Christ. And he was the one who would go after them and arrest them and even have them killed. He was there holding the coat of Stephen while Stephen was being stoned to death. And so you have this one who was an enemy to the message of Jesus Christ. But his name is Paul. But his name was Saul of Tarsus. But God had restored him. God had met him and revealed himself to him. And he recognized his error. He recognized his failure. And he's now repented and he's turned to Christ. And God gave him his new name. Christ gave him his new name and called him Paul. And so now he's no longer Saul of Tarsus. He's Paul of Jesus Christ. And so his citizenship has been changed from a citizenship of earth to a citizenship of heaven and the message of reconciliation. Now he says, I am Paul, a prisoner of Jesus Christ. So now he's in prison for exactly what he used to go out and hunt people down and kill them for, was the message of Jesus Christ. Now he's one because he's gone out and proclaimed this message and done it with great boldness and power, that now he's under arrest for that same message in which he used to persecute for. God's redemption is powerful. It can take the most cold, hard, indifferent hearts and make them soft and moldable and pliable to his will and his way, and they began to be instruments of his love and his grace and his mercy. And certainly now Paul is one of those people. Paul has now become a prisoner of Jesus Christ. He's not being held by Jesus Christ. He's being held for or because of Jesus Christ now. And then notice what he says here. Paul, a prisoner of Jesus Christ, and Timothy, our brother. So Paul and Timothy, partners together, of course, we do know in many endeavors throughout the New Testament, many different books. You got 1 and 2 Timothy, which of course we read as well as the work there that Paul had assigned Timothy to do. And so we have this wonderful duo, who was going out and sharing the good news of Jesus Christ. And then they write to this one. So Paul, a prisoner of Jesus Christ, and Timothy, our brother, unto Philemon, our dearly beloved and fellow laborer. So now they are writing to this one named Philemon. And Philemon was a person like Saul of Tarsus, a man of affluence, a man of Roman citizenship, a man of stature. And Paul had somewhere along the way met this man named Philemon, and he shared the gospel with him. And he says, man, I've heard of you, Saul. He says, no, my name is not Saul. My name is Paul. And let me tell you how that happened. And he shared the gospel with him, and Philemon became a believer. He recognized how God had taken this man and how he had changed his heart and life, which is the powerful testimony of salvation. And so now Paul has shared his testimony with Philemon, and Philemon says, man, I need that in my life as well. And so he began to be a follower of Jesus Christ. And so he began to walk and to learn and to grow in the knowledge of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. And now he is a fellow laborer. Now he is laboring in the gospel. And so while Paul and Timothy is locked up in prison for the gospel, they're writing to Philemon and saying, listen, keep on doing what you're doing. Keep on sharing the gospel. People need the Lord. And so that's what he's doing. And then he says, and to our beloved Apphia and Archippus, our fellow soldiers, and to the church that meets in the house. So what we gather from this is that this church that meets in the house of Archippus, and he now has a church that's meeting in his house, and Philemon has become a leader in that house, and they are sharing the gospel of Christ. They are sharing the teachings of Jesus Christ. And so we see here lives transformed, lives changed, lives restored by the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and then used in a mighty way. So my question is today, as we begin this journey, has Christ done that for you? Has Christ come along and through some soul that has been restored and renewed and purchased by the blood of Jesus Christ, shared the gospel with you, and you've heard that gospel, you've heard how Jesus Christ came to die for those who were separated from God because of their sin, and now you're living in that wonderful redemption as well? Well, God wants to use you as a fellow laborer, as a fellow worker of those who are around the globe being persecuted for the name of Jesus Christ, prisoners all over the world today. And one day we may become prisoners of the Lord Jesus Christ, but that doesn't stop the message of reconciliation and this wonderful life we get to have in Jesus Christ and it being able to be given to us for all of eternity. And so I pray today that as we begin this journey, that you do some studying of yourself, that you check out and see what you can learn about the book of Philemon as we study this book, because this is one of the most powerful redemptive pleas in all of the New Testament. And so I pray today you go forth mightily in the name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, and I pray that you are encouraged in the salvation of our Lord.